Morning, everyone. Am I audible to you? So today we are going to study about injuries around shoulder. We have earlier studied the two lecture regarding of orthopedics. That was the introduction to fracture and their complications. I hope all of you are very clear with those lectures, and you people are hope doing very well in this lockdown period. So moving on, today we will study about the injuries around shoulder. Myself, Dr. Atin Kundru, your officer and HOD. So today's outline that we are going to study, we will have a view of anatomy of shoulder girdle. Then there will be a lecture regarding clavicle fractures, regarding acromioclavicular joint injury, and shoulder dislocation. In shoulder dislocation, we will study the anatomy part again, classification, mechanism, pathological changes, clinical picture, diagnosis, complications, and the very important recurrent shoulder dislocation. So anatomy of the shoulder girdle, you have already studied in your anatomy lecture. So if you see the shoulder girdle, there are basically three bones. This is the scapula, and this is the clavicle, and this is the proximal part of the humerus. These three bones together, they form the shoulder girdle. This is the acromion process of scapula. This articulates with the clavicle, and this is known as acromioclavicular joint. Again, the clavicle articulates with the sternum, and this forms sternoclavicular joint. And the proximal part of the humerus, or the head of the humerus, articulates with the glenoid of scapula, forming glenohumeral joint. So these three bones together, they form the shoulder girdle. And in this today's lecture, we will study the injuries of clavicle, important joint, that is acromioclavicular joint injury, and the shoulder joint injury. Now, acromioclavicular joint is a plain synovial joint which is formed between the lateral end of clavicle and medial acromial margin, and there are two ligaments which holds this joint. One is the acromioclavicular ligament and another is the coracoclavicular ligament, from the coracoid process to the clavicle. It has got two parts. One is the conoid part and another is the trapezoid part. So the clavicle fractures, the clavicle fractures are classified into three types according to the location of the fracture. Most common is the middle part, that is middle one third, which comprises at least 80% of the clavicle fractures, and then the lateral part, that is 15%, lateral one third, and medial one third. This comprises only the 5% of the clavicle fractures. Most common childhood fracture, but it can occur at any age. So as we know, clavicle is anchored laterally to the scapula by the acromioclavicular and the coracoclavicular ligament, and medially to the sternum by the sternoclavicular ligament, and to the ribs by the costoclavicular ligament. Clavicle, ligaments and the muscles which are attached to the clavicle, like sternocleidomastoid and subclavius, these all the structure, they forms the attachment point of shoulder joint to the axial skeleton. Now there are two important structures, the brachial plexus and the subclavian vessels. They are also lies very close to the clavicle. So how does clavicle fractures occur? What is the mechanism of injury? The first is a direct blow to the clavicle. Second, there is a fall on shoulder on a outstretched hand. Now we'll see the signs and symptoms. So pain, swelling and deformity. As you know, all the fractures has got the signs like pain, swelling, deformity. Deformity is due to the upward shifting of the medial clavicle and the downward shifting of the lateral clavicle. If you see the patient comes to us with the arm held adducted and downward with support of other extremity. Sometimes there is tenting and the piercing of the overlying skin can be seen. Now to diagnose it, we do the X-ray. So routine X-ray AP, anteroposterior view of chest or clavicle. This demonstrate the fracture, as we can see in this picture, as well as the displacement. Now the displacement is very important, because if the displacement is less, that is if it is less than 2 cm, then we go for the treatment part, that is the conservative treatment. 90% cases of clavicle fractures are managed conservatively by applying brace, that is figure of 8 clavicle brace, or this is the figure of 8 clavicle brace, or the arm sling. But there are certain conditions in which we have to go for surgery, like K wire fixation or plating. So what are the condition? If the displacement is more than 2 cm, if this is an open fracture. Hope you all know about the open fracture and the closed fracture in the fracture lecture, first lecture. Dr. Anoop has already taken it. And if there is any vascular or neurological complications. So if these are the conditions, that is the displacement is more than 2 cm, if there is open fracture, if there is any vascular injury like venosus, subclavian vessels or brachial plexus injury, all these things are there, then we do the surgery, that is K-wire fixation or plating is done. But most of the time, 90% of the time, these clavicle fractures are managed conservatively by the clavicle brace or the arm sling. Another joint which is very important is the acromioclavicular joint. So acromioclavicular joint, again the mechanism, either there is the direct blow on the shoulder or fall on the outstretched hand. If you see the imaging part, in for detecting acromioclavicular joint, the X-ray of both shoulder are taken on the same film, so that we can compare the normal side from the injured side. So here you can see that this is the normal side, this is the acromion process, this is the clavicle, and the acromioclavicular joint is normal here. Whereas in this picture, this is the acromion process, this is the clavicle, and there is the joint has been disturbed. So clavicle is lying upward. So acromioclavicular joint, both sides of the shoulder are taken in the same field. Again, signs and symptoms: pain, swelling, and there is deformity. Deformity is due to the upward displacement of the lateral clavicle or the distal clavicle. As you can see in this picture, the clavicle has been raised upward. This is the AP view and this is the lateral view. The classification of acromioclavicular joint injury, it has been classified into 6 types according to the ligament injured and the displacement of the clavicle. So these are the 6 pictures. We will take it one by one. This is the type 1. In this, the ligaments are only stretched, that is the acromioclavicular ligament, there is only a sprain is there or stretching is there, no displacement is there. Type 2, there is a partial rupture of acromioclavicular ligament, there is no disturbance in the coracoclavicular ligament. So there is a just the partial rupture is there. And in type 3, there is a complete rupture of both the ligament, that is the acromioclavicular as well as the coracoclavicular ligament. So these two ligaments both are ruptured in type 3. In type 2, only AC ligament is ruptured. In type 1, just there is a sprain. But in all the three conditions, there is no displacement of the clavicle is seen. In type 4, both the ligaments are ruptured as well as the clavicle is displaced posteriorly. So clavicle displaced posteriorly over the acromion process. In type 5, there is a superior displacement of the clavicle, as we have seen in the previous x-ray. So this is the most common injury, superior displacement of the clavicle, and clavicle is seen just under the skin. And in type 6, the clavicle comes downward below the coracoid. It is a very rare condition, but the clavicle displacement is seen downward below the coracoid. So these are the 6 types. In first 3 types, type 1, type 2, type 3, the ligaments are injured but there is no displacement of the clavicle. In the type 4, type 5 and type 6, there is a displacement of the clavicle, either there is posterior, superior or downward. So why this is important to classification? Because the treatment part depends upon the type. So type 1, 2 and 3, these are treated by the conservative method like ice application, anti-inflammatory drugs and immobilization of the upper limb or the shoulder joint. Whereas in the type 4, type 5 and type 6, we require surgery. So open reduction and ligament reconstruction are required in type 4, type 5 and type 6 condition. Now the most important part is the shoulder joint. Shoulder joint, as we know, is the ball and the socket joint. It is very mobile as well as it is very unstable joint. So why it is very mobile and why it is very unstable, we can guess or we can see in the because of the anatomy, inherent anatomy of the shoulder joint. So if you see the bony part, the bony anatomy of the shoulder joint has very minimal constraints. Constraints mean the things that protects the joint. So because it has got the minimal constraints, it has got large range of motion. So that's why it's very mobile and that's why it is very unstable. So let us see one by one. The glenoid cavity or the glenoid part of the scapula, it is antiverted 30 to 40 degree. And the humeral head, that is the proximal humerus, it is retroverted. So the glenoid is antiverted, femoral head is retroverted and only the 1/4 of the head articulates with the glenoid. So not the whole of the head articulates with the glenoid, only the 1/4 of the head articulates with the glenoid. Then there is a third thing that is called as labrum. Now what is labrum? Labrum is the cartilaginous rim which is present around the glenoid, and this is one of the most important stabilizing structure. It effectively enlarges and deepens the glenoid surface and thus increases the humerus contact to up to 75%. So if you see the glenoid and the humerus directly, they are only 1/4 of the humerus is in contact with the glenoid, but the cartilaginous rim called labrum present around the glenoid, this deepens the shoulder joint or the glenoid surface, and this increases the humerus contact to 75%. So the labrum plays a very important role for stabilizing the shoulder joint. And this otherwise means one more thing, that if there is any injury to the labrum, the shoulder joint becomes more unstable. That we will see later in our further slides. Then the fourth thing is the capsule. Any joint is always surrounded by the capsule. So the capsule in the shoulder joint is loose and redundant at various positions. Only at the extremes it tightens and provides the stability. So normally the capsule of the shoulder joint is very loose. Only at the extremes it tightens and provides the stability. Now what are the muscular part or the dynamic stabilizer? It is stabilized by the rotator cuff muscles. As we all know about the rotator cuff muscles, comprises of four muscles. As we can see in this picture, subscapularis, this is the major muscle. Then comes supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and the teres minor. Another thing is the long head of the biceps tendon. This passes along the rotator interval. This is the rotator cuff, and along the rotator interval, the long head of the biceps tendon. And the coracoacromial arch, this is the coracoacromial arch. It comprises of coracoid process, coracoacromial ligament, and the acromion process. These three structure, coracoid process, coracoacromial ligament, and the acromion process, this is known as coracoacromial arch. This prevents the superior translation of the humerus head. So if you see the anatomy part, the bony part we have already seen, which labrum plays an important role, and the muscular part, these are the structures which stabilizes the shoulder joint. Now what is shoulder dislocation by definition? Shoulder dislocation is when the head of the humerus separates from the glenoid cavity of the scapula at the glenohumeral joint. So this is the head of the humerus. This is the glenoid cavity in this x-ray. So when the head of the humerus, as we can see in this picture, separates from the, this is the glenoid cavity. So this is known as the shoulder dislocation. Epidemiology, this is the commonest joint in the body to dislocate. If you see the age group, it is found in men, most commonly in 20 to 30 year age group, where the male to female ratio is 9:1. Whereas in women, it is more common in the older age group, that is 61 to 80 year, where the male to female ratio is 1:3. It is less common in children as their epiphyseal plate is weaker. And so before dislocating, there is always a tendency to fracture of the bone. So why it is more common in elder? It is more common in elder as the collagen fibers have the fewer cross links, so there is weaker capsule, tendons, and the ligaments. So this is a very brief about the epidemiology. Now important thing, what are the types of dislocation? basically there are three types of dislocation: anterior, posterior and inferior. So the anterior dislocation is the most common type. 95% of the shoulder dislocation are of anterior type. So what is anterior dislocation? When the head of the humerus comes out and lies anterior to the glenoid. Now there are four types of anterior dislocation depending upon the position of the humeral head. First is the subcoracoid type. This is the most common type. Here the head of the humerus lies below the coracoid process. Pre-glenoid, head of the humerus lies in front of the glenoid. Subclavicular, head of the humerus lies below the clavicle. And intrathoracic type, where the head of the humerus lies inside the thoracic cavity. So these are the four types of anterior dislocation depending upon the position of the humeral head where it gets dislocated. Posterior dislocation, it is about 4% less common, but most commonly missed because it presents with less pain. Here the head of the humerus lies backwards the glenoid cavity. How the posterior dislocation takes place? Usually any violent internal rotational force that occurs with during a fall on forward flexed internally rotated arm. The arm is internally rotated with flexion. So example, in the case of any epileptic seizures or in electric shock. So any violent rotational force where the arm is internally rotated and flexed and patient falls on the ground. In that case, usually the posterior dislocation takes place. Then third is the inferior dislocation known as luxatio erecta. It's very less common, less than 1%, a rare condition. So in this condition, the head lies in the subglenoid position, usually due to hyperabduction injury. There is a higher rate of vascular, nervous, ligament and tendon injuries. So these are the pictures of posterior dislocation. We can see in the posterior dislocation, the head of the humerus lies posterior to the glenoid cavity. And this is the inferior dislocation. This is the hyperabduction. And in this condition, this is the head of the humerus. This comes to lie below the glenoid, so subglenoid. So this is the inferior dislocation and this is the posterior dislocation. The mechanism of injury. Anterior dislocation, firstly the fall on the shoulder joint which is abducted and externally rotated. As you can see in this picture, this is abduction and external rotation. If in this condition the patient falls, there will be the anterior dislocation. Secondly, direct blow from behind. Any direct blow from behind which pushes the head out of the glenoid anteriorly. So these are the two conditions in which there is anterior dislocation. Posterior dislocation, direct force from the front. When the arm is adducted, internally rotated, driving the head backwards. We have already discussed this regarding the epilepsy or electric shock. When there is a violent internal force where the arm is adducted and internally rotated, and this causes the direct force and this pushes the head backwards. Inferior dislocation, arm is hyperabducted and elbow is often flexed behind the head. Now the pathological changes that takes place during the shoulder dislocation. Firstly, Bunkart's lesion. So what is Bunkart's lesion? This lesion is seen in the anterior dislocation. There is the stripping of glenoid labrum. As we have already studied, the labrum is the cartilaginous rim around the glenoid. So stripping of the glenoid labrum along with the periosteum from the anteroinferior surface of the glenoid. So this is the labrum part of the glenoid, and there is a stripping of the glenoid labrum and the periosteum of the anteroinferior surface of the scapula. So this is the Bunkart lesion. Sometimes there is also the avulsion of the glenoid rim, anteroinferior glenoid rim causes bony Bunkart lesion. So this is the bony Bunkart lesion. We can see there is the avulsion fracture of the anteroinferior glenoid part. So this is the Bunkart lesion. Mostly it is seen in the always it is seen in the anterior dislocation. Then the Hill-Sachs lesion. Hill-Sachs lesion is the depression on the humeral head in the posterolateral quadrant. So this is also seen in the anterior dislocation. Why? Due to the impingement of the anterior edge of the glenoid. As you can see, this is the anterior edge of the glenoid, and when there is anterior dislocation, humerus head lies anterior to the glenoid. There is an impingement of the anterior edge of the glenoid on the head. And which part of the head? Posterolateral part of the head. So there is a depression in the humeral head seen in the posterolateral quadrant. Other pathological changes that takes place are the rounding off or the eburnation of the anterior portion of the glenoid rim due to bone loss. There may be the fractures of the greater tuberosity. 15% is seen, and it is usually seen in the patients more than 45 years. Rotator cuff tear, it is seen in 50% of the patient less than 40 years and 80% of the patient more than 60 years. There will be inability to abduct the arm even after the reduction. Axillary nerve injury, this is the most common neurological injury seen in the shoulder dislocation, mostly seen in 12% of the cases. How it can be assessed? It can be assessed by testing the strength of the motor strength of the deltoid and sensory by the pin prick sensation over the lateral aspect of the arm. So to revise it, what are the pathological changes? We can see the Bunkart's lesion, Hill-Sachs lesion, rounding of the anterior portion of the glenoid rim, greater tuberosity fracture, rotator cuff tear, and the axillary nerve injury. Now the clinical picture. Most commonly pain, and depending upon the type of dislocation, we can see how the picture is seen. The patient usually holds the injured limb with the other hand close to the trunk, and the shoulder is abducted. As we can see in the anterior dislocation, there is shoulder is abducted and internally rotated, and the elbow is kept flexed. So this is the position of the hand by which patient comes to us. Shoulder is abducted, internally rotated, and the elbow flexed, and with the help of other hand, there is a support is given. So this is the position in the clinical picture in the anterior dislocation. Whereas in the posterior dislocation, what we can see, the arm is adducted and internally rotated. On examination, what are the things that we can see? There is a loss of the normal round contour of the shoulder. So whenever there is a dislocation, the normal round contour of the shoulder there is absent, and we can feel the on palpation we can feel the step here. Then again on palpation we can see the anterior bulge. If there is anterior dislocation, we can palpate the anterior bulge of the head of the humerus, or in the posterior dislocation it can be seen in the posterior side. On palpating the glenoid socket, it can be seen that there is glenoid socket is empty. Some tests which are given like Dugas test. What is Dugas test? In Dugas test, if the patient is asked to touch the opposite shoulder, the patient is unable to touch the opposite shoulder. And Hamilton's ruler test. So because there is a flattening of the shoulder, the rounding of the shoulder is absent, so there is a flattening of the shoulder. A ruler, that is a scale, we can place a ruler on the lateral aspect of the arm, touching the acromion process superiorly and lateral condyle of the humerus inferiorly. So this is known as Hamilton's ruler test because of the loss of the normal round contour of the shoulder. So these are the things that we can examine. Now we come to the diagnosis part, how to diagnose it. So firstly, imaging, X-ray, the radiographic evaluation. So there are three views which are mentioned to see the shoulder dislocation. First is the anteroposterior view. This is the normal anteroposterior view. Patient is lying supine. This is the shoulder X-ray beam and this is the plate. So normal anteroposterior view, and sometimes to visualize it clearly, there is internal rotation, as we can see in this thing, 45 degree internal rotation, again sometimes 45 degree external rotation. So internal rotation or external rotation, the true AP view, this is the true AP view, or sometimes anteroposterior view are taken in the internal rotation as well as external rotation, depending upon the type of dislocation. So one is the anteroposterior view, another is the scapular Y view, that is the scapula, and third is the axillary view. These are the three views by which the X-ray is done and dislocation is identified. Let us see one by one. So this is the anteroposterior view showing anterior dislocation. This is the anteroposterior view of pre-reduction. As you can see, this is the head of the humerus. This is the glenoid cavity. This is the coracoid process, and this is the HH, means head of the humerus. So this HH, or the head of the humerus, is lying anterior to the glenoid. So this is the pre-reduction and post-reduction. After reducing, the how the reduction is done, we will discuss it later. After reduction, this can be seen. This is the head of the humerus, this is the glenoid coracoid process, and this arrow is showing the Hill sac lesion, as we have discussed it earlier. So this is the AP view of, or anteroposterior view of, anterior dislocation. Now posterior dislocation, the anteroposterior view of posterior dislocation, this is the view. Here the head of the humerus is lying posterior to the glenoid cavity, and on X-ray, on in the AP view, this is a typical light bulb sign, as you can appreciate it. So the bulb which used to be earlier, we used to use it. This is the light bulb sign. Head of the humerus appears as it in the posterior dislocation, and this is the inferior dislocation. Again in the anteroposterior view, the head of the humerus lies inferior to the glenoid cavity, and it is easily appreciable, the inferior dislocation. So after the anteroposterior view, another is the scapular Y view. This is the scapula. Patient is turning in this position, 45 degree oblique, and X-ray beam is shoot from superiorly, and the film is plate is kept below the scapula. So this is the scapular Y view. If you see the X-ray, this is the Y scapula is seen in this view. And if you see the head of the humerus, this is the head of the humerus, this is the humerus bone, this is the humerus bone, and this is the head of the humerus. So this head of the humerus is lying anteriorly. Again, this is the pre-reduction X-ray. This is a scapular view, head of the humerus lying anteriorly. Post-reduction, we can again see this head of the humerus is lying in the, this is the glenoid cavity. So the head of the humerus is lying in the glenoid cavity. This is the post-reduction X-ray. So this is also one view, that is a scapular Y view taken to confirm the shoulder dislocation. The axial view, this is the axial view of the shoulder joint. As we can see, this is the glenohumeral part, glenoid process, this is the proximal humerus, and this is the coracoid process. Proximal humerus, glenoid process, coracoid process. This is the glenohumeral part, and this is the normal axial view. We can see in this case, this is the anterior dislocation, the head of the humerus lying anterior to the glenoid cavity. This is the head of the humerus lying anterior to the glenoid cavity. So there are three views. One is the anteroposterior view, scapular Y view, and axial view to confirm the shoulder dislocation. Other investigating modes like CT scan or computed tomography, this is useful in defining the humeral head or glenoid impression fractures, loose bodies, and anterior labral bony injuries, as we have already mentioned in the bony Bankart's lesion. So to confirm these fractures, bony fractures, humeral head fractures, any loose bodies, CT scan or computed tomography is done. Then arthrography. Arthrography is the study of the joint by using contrast. Single or double contrast arthrography is utilized to evaluate rotator cuff injuries or rotator cuff pathological process. And then MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, this is the investigation of choice for identifying any soft tissue pathology like rotator cuff injury, capsular injury, labral injury. So all these things can be easily identified by MRI. Now management part of the shoulder dislocation. So this is an emergency. Shoulder dislocation should be reduced within 24 hours. Emergency reduction is done under anesthesia and it should be reduced under 24 hours, or otherwise there will be avascular necrosis of the head of the humerus. Further or late complication is there. So to avoid it, head of the humerus should be reduced within 24 hours and it is an emergency process. It should be done, it should be reduced, and it should be reduced under anesthesia. After reduction, the limb should be immobilized or strapped to the trunk or the arm, chest for 3 to 4 weeks, at least 3 to 4 weeks in patients less than 30 years and rested in collar and cuff. But in patients who are more than 30 years, the immobilization is recommended not more than 7 to 10 days, because it has been seen that in a later age group there are chances of shoulder stiffness is there. So the immobilization is done for less duration, that is at least two weeks is sufficient, and then we start the physiotherapy or the exercises part. But in any condition, abduction and external rotations are prohibited. So how the reduction is done, there are various maneuvers, we will discuss it. So these are the, there are various methods to reduce shoulder joint, but we'll study only about the these four methods. First is the Kocher's technique, second the Hippocrates method, third Stimson's technique, and fourth the traction counter traction method. So what is Kocher's technique? How to reduce shoulder joint with Kocher's maneuver? So four things are done. First is the traction. Traction with the elbow is flexed at the right angle. Steady traction applied along the long axis of the humerus. So with the elbow is flexed and along the long axis of the humerus, continuous traction is given. After providing the traction, then what we do? We slightly rotate the arm externally. Traction is given, arm is rotated externally. Then after rotating the arm externally, we externally rotated arm is adducted. Now it is adduction is done midline across the body, and after doing the adduction, this arm is again internally rotated. So traction, external rotation, adduction, this arm is adduction, and this arm which is externally rotated, now this is internally rotated. So traction, external rotation, adduction and internal rotation, these are the four steps which is done under anesthesia to reduce the shoulder joint. So a short form is given TEAI. T jo chai peete hain hum log, TI. Then Hippocrates maneuver. So in this condition, what we can see in this picture, the arm is slightly abducted or semi-abducted. The arm is semi-abducted and traction is given. Surgeon puts his foot on the axillary part. He keeps his foot in the axilla against the chest wall, and while providing the giving this traction, this the manipulation of the joint is done. The head of the humerus is levered back into the position or in the glenoid using the foot as the fulcrum. So this is the Hippocrates maneuver. Stimson's technique. In the Stimson technique, the patient is placed prone on the stretcher. The affected shoulder is hanging off the edge and weights 10 to 15 pounds. These are fastened to the wrist, and this provides constant traction. And after few minutes, this shoulder gets reduced. So these are some techniques. But usually, we do Kocher's maneuver and the traction counter traction. These are the two methods that we are using commonly. But for your knowledge sake, there are other methods are there, so you should know about the other methods also. So what is traction counter traction? The assistant, we need two people here, and assistant applies the counter traction with the folded sheet wrapped around the upper chest. This folded sheet is there. The assistant provides the counter traction and examiner applies traction to the arm in the infralateral direction. So constant traction is given, constant counter traction is given, and the shoulder gets reduced here. So these are the four methods. First is the Kocher's method, second is the Hippocrates method, Stimson's method, and traction counter traction. So reduction is very important and should be done within 24 hours under anesthesia. Now, what are the complications of the shoulder joint? There are early complications and the late complications. Early complications like axillary nerve injury, we have already studied about this in the pathology, axillary nerve injury, rotator cuff injury, glenoid rim fractures and the greater tuberosity fractures. So these are the early complications. Then comes the late complications. As we have already said that it is an emergency, it should be reduced within 24 hours. Otherwise, there are chances of avascular necrosis of the humeral head. So this is one of the late complication. Then the shoulder joint stiffness. So that's also we have mentioned that in older age group, that is more than 30 years, the immobilization is done for lesser duration to avoid this shoulder joint stiffness. So avascular necrosis of humeral head, shoulder joint stiffness, and then recurrent shoulder dislocations. So this is very important thing. There are many patients in which there are chances of further shoulder dislocation, which is called as recurrent shoulder dislocation. So why there is recurrent shoulder dislocation in some patient, we will study it. Again, the same thing, if we go to the patho-anatomy part. Primary deficiency, as we have already mentioned, that shoulder joint is inherently unstable. The glenoid is smaller, shallower as compared to the humeral head. We have already studied that only 1/4 of the humeral head articulates with the glenoid, and the labrum plays the major role for the shoulder joint stability. Then there are other lesions which are responsible for the recurrency, like Bunkard's lesion, Hill-Sack lesion, eburnation of glenoid rim, glenoid labrum tears, and capsular stretching. So these are, we have already studied about this thing in the pathology of the shoulder dislocation. These are all these pathology are responsible for the recurrence. So how to diagnose the recurrent shoulder dislocation? Firstly, the patient will give a history of dislocation, and some tests are done. One is the apprehension test. What is apprehension test? The patient is sitting or supine, shoulder is kept at 90 degree of abduction. We apply external rotation force at the extremity, and whenever we apply the external rotation force, the patient, there will be apprehension or pain is seen. So this is the apprehension test to find out the recurrency of the shoulder dislocation. Then anterior drawer test. Anterior drawer test you will see in also in the knee joint, there is anterior drawer test, and also in the shoulder joint. So what happens? The patient is lying supine. Now what examiner does, it holds the shoulder joint with one hand and with other hand the arm, and it tries to push it. So anterior laxity is seen, and this it compares with both the shoulder. So with patient supine, examiner compares the anterior laxity with the opposite shoulder. This is known as anterior drawer test. Then radiological diagnosis for recurrent, again the X-ray, we can see the Hill-Sack lesion. MRI, we have already seen the Bunkard's lesion. Now treatment part, how to manage recurrent shoulder dislocation. So recurrent shoulder dislocation is managed by doing surgery. So there are various surgeries, name of the surgery you must know, and what we do in each surgery, that you must know. So one by one, putty plait operation, Bunkard's operation, Bristow's operation, and arthroscopic Bunkard repair. Putty plait operation, what we do in the putty plait is, as we know, this is the subscapularis muscle. In this subscapularis muscle, we put an incision, we cut it. After cutting it, this shortening of the capsule and overlapping, which is also known as double breasting, overlapping or double breasting of subscapularis tendon is performed to prevent external rotation and abduction. So this is the subscapularis muscle which is loose. We cut it and double breasting is done. As we can see in this picture, this part is tightened at this part. So there is a shortening. Again, the capsule, is also shortened. So shortening of the capsule and double breasting of the subscapularis tendon is done, and this prevents the external rotation and the abduction. So this is done in the putty plot operation. Then the Bunkart's operation. What is Bunkart? What we do in the Bunkart's operation? The labrum, as we know that in Bunkart's there is a tear of the labrum. The glenoid labrum and the capsule are reattached to the front of the glenoid rim. This is the glenoid rim. In this glenoid rim, anteriorly the labrum and the capsule, which has been torn, they are again attached, reattached with the help of sutures, anchor sutures. These are the anchor sutures. With the help of these anchor sutures, we reattach the labrum, which has labrum and the capsule, which are torn. So this is done by in the Bunkart's operation. This can be done by the two method. One is the by open method, and another is the arthroscopic method. We will study in the next couple of slide. Another is the Bristow's operation. What is Bristow's operation? Here the coracoid process along with the attached muscle, it is osteotomy of the coracoid process is done at its base, and it is fixed to the lower half of anterior margin. This is the glenoid. In the lower half of anterior margin of the glenoid, this cut coracoid process along with the muscle attached is fixed here with the help of two screw. So coracoid process along with the attached muscle cut at its base are fixed to the lower half of the anterior margin of the glenoid. The muscle attached to the coracoid process, it also provides support to the head of the humerus. So this is done in the Bristow's operation. So I was mentioning in the Bunkart surgery, there are two methods by which we do the Bunkart repair. So what we do in the Bunkart repair, as we have already mentioned, the glenoid labrum, which is tear or torn, are attached, reattached with the help of sutures or anchor sutures. Now this can be done by two method. One is the open method, where we put the long incision and subcutaneous tissue are cut, and then we reach up to the capsule and we repair the glenoid labrum. This is one method. But in today's era, arthroscopy. What is arthroscopy? Arthroscopy is the machine by which we visualize the joint. Any scope, you have learned about the endoscope, laparoscope, used to visualize the area. Similarly, arthroscope is used to visualize the joint, and to visualize the joint and to do this surgery, the different portals are made on the shoulder joint. As you can see, there are three portals. One by which we put the anchor sutures. This is the arthroscope, second portal arthroscope, and with the help of this scope, which is attached to the computer monitor or any monitor having light source. So all the things inside the joint can be visualized in the monitor. And this is the third portal for the cannula. So what, whenever the we do any surgery, there are various fluid or blood are there to make it clear, we suck it by cannula. So the cannula is kept here, which causes the suction, and this is the arthroscope by which we visualize the structure in the monitor. And after visualizing the structure and identifying the structure, we put the suture cannula in the third portal. So these are the different portals are made, and we repair the glenoid Bankart's lesion with the help of suture, but no need of a long incision or blood loss. And so what are the advantages of the arthroscopy over the open Bankart surgery? As you can see that because we can visualize it, the accurate diagnosis of all structures are done. So only three portals are made, so less morbidity and less pain, small scars are seen, faster recovery is seen, and patient can very soon return to the activities. So these are all the advantages of the arthroscopic Bankart repair. And what are the disadvantages? As we know that this is a technically demanding surgery, various, it requires a long learning curve, and it requires the costly equipment also. Arthroscope is quite costly, so it requires the equipment, and it's technically demanding, and it has got a higher failure rate than the open surgery, because lack of versatility. What is lack of versatility? That means in the open surgery we can change the procedure. Suppose if you are planning for Bankart surgery, and if we can see that some other things has to be done, we can change it. Putty plot can be done, or Bristow's can be done. So versatility is there in the open surgery, but in the arthroscopic surgery we can do only the one surgery. So this is one the disadvantages of the arthroscopic surgery, but there are various major advantages. So people or the patient is demanding for arthroscopic surgery rather than the open surgery. So this we finish with the surgical part of the recurrent shoulder dislocation, and I think today's lecture. So now it's time to answer your query. I would like to answer your query. Hope I was audible to all of you. You all are writing about thank you, and I'm also very much thankful to you. But if there is any query, I will be very happy to solve it out. Or you can go through this lecture, as I think. Okay, so the scapular YBU. This is the scapular Y view. Patient is lying oblique, and we take the X-ray of the scapula. Although this view is not done in a routine cases, this is just for your theoretical knowledge that these are the things that are done. So here we can see the scapula is focused from the superior part. the x-ray is focused from the superior part, film is the x-ray plate on which the x-ray is, has been shooting is done, is kept below the patient or arm, and x-ray beam is from the just, it is oblique, the patient is lying 45 degree oblique. So this is the, here the scapula view is taken, and on the x-ray if you see, this is the prone position, the patient is lying in the semi-prone position, rather to say patient is lying semi-prone and 45 degree oblique, and this is the x-ray beam and this is the plate, and we focus on the scapula. If you see the scapula, this is the scapula Y view, one is the coracoid process, this is the, and this is the spine of scapula, this is the spine of scapula, this is the glenoid cavity, and the head of the humerus is lying, this is the humerus. If you try to appreciate this picture, this is the humerus bone, and this is the head of the humerus. This is lying anterior to the glenoid joint, glenoid cavity. This is the pre-reduction x-ray anterior dislocation, and when we reduce it, the head of the humerus comes back to the glenoid part. So this is the post-reduction x-ray. Okay then, thank you for patience hearing. We will meet with orthopedic lecture. Let's see what will be your next topic on next Friday. Thank you.